Parental discretion is advised.
This show is brought to you by Slice on Broadway, supporting Pittsburgh podcasting with the perfect pepperoni pizza, sliceonbroadway.com. And listeners like you, support this show at patreon.com/wrestlingmayhemshow. Just wait, just wait. Hey guys, it's the Wrestling Mayhem Show, episode 511. 511 Tuesdays we've been doing this. I'm Mike Sorg, at Sorgatron on the Twitters, here in Mayhem Studios in beautiful Pittsburgh, PA. Tacos. Anyways, we have a fine collection of Mayhemers with us tonight, and later tonight we're going to have the Patreon in the bank. Where's it at? I got my Patreon in the bank, ready to cash in. Well, I'm not, but this is all the Patreon money is in here. There you go. With us tonight to talk wrestling from across the nation. First of all, we're going to go all the way up to Poughkeepsie, New York. It's Mad Mike, the former employee of WWE.
Sorg, Mayhem Media tonight's going to be a lot of fun. Also, wrestling happened.
Right. We'll get to all that stuff. And also with us, from right here in the greater Pittsburgh area, we got to hang out at Raw last night here in Pittsburgh. It's Mainstream Matt. Is that one big board? Holy crap.
Big board's back, buddy.
Oh man.
All right. It's the only possible way to keep things organized tonight was to re-unleash the big board.
Uh-huh.
See?
There it is.
So that's going to happen later on. It's big. It's a board. Mayhem Mania, Patreon in the background.
There you go.
I've already spoken with some of the Patreons about their moves. It's going to be calamitous. There's going to be hurt feelings.
There's going to be
broken hearts. But as we said, Sorg, you can't build a better WrestleMania without breaking a few hearts.
Or
call me Shawn Michaels because I'm gonna be the heartbreaker.
Or apparently, according to the real WrestleMania, bones and necks and all kinds of other body parts. So, also with us, I believe he is one of those Patreon contributors this week. I need to look at the list because apparently it's bigger than usual. He's Alex Cars. Power to the Smarks. They got a podcast now too, over there. Well, I mean, of course, it's your car in 15 minutes as well. But Alex Cars, how you doing?
I'm doing good, man. Like Dolph Ziggler, I am here to show the world as a Patreon in the bank. I've got my John Cena training shirt on, and I am ready to rise above in this round of Mayhem Mania.
Did you order John Cena's new book in the?
Man, I'm still on a budget. I might have a job, but I'm still on a college student budget.
That's right. No room for books. That's what libraries are for.
I feel like the cover.
Unless they're on Kindle.
I feel like the cover of the John Cena book should just be a coloring book.
Yeah, I could see that. Anyways.
It looked like a color wheel of his shirts.
It did. Anyways, you can check out all the stuff around the show over at WrestlingMayhemShow.com. Subscribe to us on iTunes and all the other audio and video formats on Facebook. We have video up there on YouTube, Stitcher, Spreaker, iHeartRadio, and coming soon, whenever they release it over on the Google Play Music store, they're going to have podcasts very shortly. We are signed up for it, so look for us there on Android or other devices when that pops up. You can also drop us a line to that email address.
Good times
at WrestlingMayhemShow.com or that phone number at 412-206-WMS0. You can also do other things. Join us live here Tuesdays, live.WrestlingMayhemShow.com around 9 p.m. Eastern time. You get a little bonus content, the stuff that we usually send to the Patreon people, but you get it in person. Sometimes it's so offensive, we won't even send it to Patreon. There's a question mark tonight. I'm just going to put it there. But you can do that every Tuesday night, live.WrestlingMayhemShow.com. Also, we're streaming live, as we were reminded, our good friends, the 405 Radio, they periodically and featured on the site at the 405. You can check out the link over on WrestlingMayhemShow.com as well. And, of course, big thanks to our Patreon supporters. Of course, this is the big Patreon in the bank tonight. So we have six people that were reached out to, apparently. And I can't, this new design, I don't know how to get to our Patreon supporters. Where do I get to that, guys? Where do I get to those?
Jeez, Sorg, I know them right off the top of my head. Right. You want me to run them off for you?
Who supports us, Mad Mike?
We're in the chat. Are in the stream with
That's
you.
That's right,
from
Matt Carlin.
From least to most important, the Patreons are Alex Cars from Power to the Smarks, Mad Mike from Pooh Kipsy,
New money
York.
At the screen.
Making It Rain, the Matthew and Jennifer Carlin's Foundation for Podcast Betterment, Ed Burke, who we never see, Antonio Garza from the Wrestling Revolution, and Bo Diggity.
Woo! There you go. You can support us. And, of course, the time has passed for Patreon in the bank, but there's other goodies that we do throughout the year as well. Patreon.com/WrestlingMayhemShow. So let's get into
the I don't know. If somebody runs in your door right now with a suitcase full of $50, I think you'll let them in, sir.
I think I locked the door.
Ah, you should. Sword,
that's sword. A good
most
answer.
Most of the people that come in through that door will not care if it's locked. They will break it down.
This is true. This is absolutely true.
Especially if they can smell the pizza.
There you go. We'll get to the pizza a little later. Got some of that right here. So, yeah, there you go. Yeah, in arm's length. Everything needs to be in arm's length when you're in the studio, right? If I want to wear a Rey Mysterio mask, boom, get it from that out. Don't want to do that. It's really creepy. It doesn't have eyes anymore. Okay, let's talk about pro wrestling. So, Raw happened last night. Roadblock was this weekend. The speed bump to WrestleMania. The mild inconvenience to WrestleMania, but you guys talked about it a good bit last night, and with new names that I wasn't even sure about. Good job, thanks guys for
WWE Detour.
WWE Detour, for instance, is like all of it is
WWE Bylane,
but
WWE Slippery When Wet,
WWE Rest Stop,
WWE HOV Lane,
WWE Falling Rocks,
WWE Suicidal Deer,
WWE Merge. I don't know what Merge does, but...
Merge is TNA.
That's when the SmackDown and Raw come together.
Oh, man.
Wow. Okay, but no, when I was in Pittsburgh, there was a lot of stuff that happened. Of course, Roadblock, fallout from that as well, which I don't know if there's really much fallout that really happened from Roadblock. It's just kind of a Saturday Night's main event that happened in retrospect, right? First of all, I want your thoughts. What did you guys think of Roadblock? Because I don't think we've done a recap or anything on that. I know a lot of people probably watched it this weekend. I watched it kind of in parts because I was doing a wrestling show with IWC and Colt Cabana and stuff that night. So I like these live events. I like these where we didn't bother to bring the full set and the full lighting, and we didn't even put the ring in the middle of the place. Like, they put the ring. Like, did you guys see the wide shot where there was the board for the hockey, and it was, like, over here? Right? Like, that aisle was the longest I've ever seen an aisle since, like, WrestleMania 3, right? I don't know. What were your initial thoughts on that, Mike?
I really liked the show. I thought it was a lot of fun. The setup was really good.
Mm-hmm.
It reminded me of the old, like, MSG pay-per-views where you would just have Survivor Series, then the entrance, and you walk down to the ring. I thought the matches were really good. I was a little disappointed they didn't take a few more risks, but you know, we kind of, that was a pipe dream that we expected them to do it anyway. But, the NXT guys, Enzo and Cass and the Revival, they stepped it up. That was a really good match. And I loved the Sammy and Stardust match. That was one of my favorite ones on the card.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. That's kind of my feeling too. Like, I loved these matches that didn't, in retrospect, you know, they didn't have a lot riding on them, but at the moment they were great matches and they were placeholder things, being, you know, Sammy and Stardust, as you mentioned. I felt Natty and Charlotte had a lot of fun to it. It was a really good match. And even a little bit, Jericho, maybe not to a lesser degree, Jericho and Swagger. It was like, well crap, we haven't seen Swagger for a while. Right. Bunch of Canadians in Toronto saying "We the People" was a little weird, but
okay. Very weird.
But especially, like, that just seemed like an odd pairing in Toronto. Was Jericho running down Canada? How he moved to America, and then we bring out Mr. America next, right?
We didn't bring back Mr. America, Sork. He's in a court trial.
Oh, right. Right.
Yeah.
In a court trial. What about you, Alex? Did you get a chance to catch the show?
I actually did not, but I've been kind of reading up on the results on it. It seemed like a really good show, and frankly, I was quite happy. I think, to be honest, I was really just happy that they did something as bold as put, like, the NXT tag titles in a show. Now, granted, I know it was technically a house show that they later made into a network special, but still, you know, it's just kind of that thought of having those guys kind of step up.
Mm-hmm.
So.
Well, yeah, it's like the first main roster exposure to Enzo and Cass, which they're going to be the next ones moving up, so we kind of need that a little bit, I think.
Yeah,
yeah, they got to be. What about you, Matt? Did you catch the show?
I did. I watched it live. So I didn't have to worry about not knowing what was going to happen. And I thought Charlotte and Natalia was off the chain. Unbelievable. Awesome. Just Natty was in all her wrestling glory. They like worked a body scissor at the beginning of the match. That was awesome. Like Natty used her elbows to get out of a body scissor. It was freaking great. So great. And like maximum credit to, I love house shows because you know there's not going to be a title change, but then if you get a good match, they could like somehow brainwash you into thinking you're going to see a title change. And they did that twice. They did that in with Natty and Charlotte, and they did that with Dean and Triple H. Both those matches were awesome.
Amazing. I thought it was pretty good. And I thought, you know, as I was talking to somebody over the weekend, I think at another wrestling show, I was saying how, you know, this is WWE kind of flexing its flexibility muscles a little bit, right? I think I said this also, you know, Elimination Chamber, MSG live special, to be able to do something like this. And I think it also gave them something, because if you think about it, there was nothing big in March, right? Like, there's no pay-per-view in March. There's not even an NXT TakeOver. So I feel like they kind of did this to give you something. If you're somebody that really kind of said, well, my $9.99 is for the pay-per-views, to say, I got something this month. I got Roadblock, you know, or.
I think it really helps because, like, yeah, you're right. The gap between Fastlane and WrestleMania is so long. It just kind of, it feels like it gets like the creative back into the routine that you're used to. So even though they are kind of like long building a couple matches here and there, they're also giving you those matches that they're building to at Roadblock. And now that Roadblock is over, they're jumping in and we've got 3 weeks left till Mania, and they're starting to ramp up with the rest of the undercard. It just feels like, it feels more like the routine. It doesn't feel like we're going to be sitting here next week or the week after it being like, well, let's WrestleMania just get here anyways. I'm sick of waiting for it. I feel like that kind of sets in because it just takes forever for them to play these things out. And it's not like anything's really going to happen. You know, they tell you the matches they're going to be, and WWE is going to do what WWE always does when they're building their matches and laying out their feuds, and you're just going to get that usual stuff. So we might as well just shorten up the time span and get through it quickly.
It kind of feels like that they use this to get some of the other stuff out of the way, though. Like, they did this to get Dean Ambrose out of the picture because everyone seemingly wants Dean in the picture. So they're like, fine, we'll throw them a bone. We'll have Dean get a pin on Triple H, and then it won't count for reasons that have never been used before in a wrestling match.
Dean has a knack for always losing big matches in ways you've never seen people lose wrestling matches before.
Yeah, I mean, Sorg was talking about his iPad electrocuting him. Sorg's basically a Dean Ambrose of this podcast.
Yeah.
Because Dean had monitors blow up on him, and that's never happened before.
Nope.
Apparently, pins don't count if the person who's doing the pin's foot is under the rope. That's never been a thing.
Yeah, it has.
No, but it hasn't.
I see it all the time.
The person getting pinned with their feet under the rope, yes. That's been a thing. Yokozuna used to pin people while holding onto the ropes after a bonsai drop.
We need to get Jimmy Corderas on the line and ask.
We do.
This needs to be asked.
Plus, they never showed us all the angles. I don't think his foot was under that bomb rope.
They gave us a very detailed spot shadow, but that said, Dean was screwed. So, but it's better that way. I'd rather Dean get screwed than just lose. But he did get screwed, and he did just lose. So we kind of got
back into the left.
Back into the left.
Back to the left.
Dean Ambrose theory. I thought it was pretty good going into things. Of course, we knew going into Pittsburgh, like everybody was going to be there, and everybody was there. And I was surprised. Like I think I said this in reaction to you guys' Raw wrap up last night. Like you really feel like, Mike, that nothing really kind of happened last night aside from Roman coming back?
No, I mean I feel like they wasted a good portion of the show on something that ultimately didn't happen.
You're talking about the Dolph Ziggler thing.
The Dolph Ziggler thing and the Vince, Shane, and Undertaker thing.
Okay.
Because honestly, those were the two biggest segments, and they ultimately meant nothing. Like, I'm still excited for the Hell in a Cell match. I think that's going to be a fantastic match. I wish we had an actual reason for it.
Mm-hmm.
Because there doesn't seem to be one. I still think the match is going to be fun, but
there is a reason. There is a stipulation for the
match. Yeah, but there's no reason
to take over Raw. Now, I know the Undertaker has no reason, but to me, that's part of the mystery and the mystique of the match. Almost is that you're not, even after he's chokeslammed Shane, you're still kind of like, why the hell is he doing that? I think that's part of the story. To be honest with you.
I don't think there is a story.
I think there's a ton of story.
Who said it last night on the Hangout? I think it might have been Bobby. Someone said that. What if inside the lockbox is the Undertaker's urn? I mean, that's a really cool story.
Mm-hmm.
Like inside the lockbox is the control of the Undertaker.
Here's the other question:
would make sense.
Do you really think the lockbox is actually going to come out up as a story element here in the near future?
You see, this is how spoiled we are by Lucha Underground Sword. This is what has happened, because now all of us will look at WWE television, which has never given us anything with subtext in its entire existence, and we're going to try to look for hidden meanings.
Sorg, it's been over a year and a half. Still, one of my favorite characters on Lucha Underground has never been fucking seen. That's how good that program is.
Listen, just
one
because
of my favorite characters has only been seen on a digital comic. Like, that's a thing that exists. Right. We've never actually seen him.
Just because you like saying Matanza. You know, I mean,
because it's so fucking good to have a monster who will eat people locked in a cage and threaten to use them.
Okay, speaking of crazy theories, here's my theory on what's in that lockbox: a Red Bull figure.
If anything, it's going to be Hornswoggle sponsoring Red Bull. It's just going to be a giant lockbox.
Paternity papers are in the lockbox.
As soon as you open the lockbox, Hornswoggle flies away. And he just screams, "Red Bull gives you wings!"
And Mr.
Kennedy's contract is in that lockbox.
We dare not speak his name.
I think it's a bag of chicken fries and grilled Burger King hot dogs that have never rotted.
That's true.
It's that a bag happen. Of Skittles.
It's Skittles.
Fruity, delicious Skittles.
Wow. Yeah.
Sorgatron, yes. We were kind of buzzing around this point before we got sidetracked and started talking about the lockbox. But you were talking to Mad Mike about how nothing really happened at Raw. And maybe it didn't. I don't really care, because whenever I go to a live event, I get like completely sucked in. And I swear I'm convinced, right, no matter what show I'm at, I'm at the best wrestling show I've ever been to in my life. My brain just wants to believe this. And then I listen to a couple people do a recap. You guys, of course, first and foremost. Maybe those other also-rans, whatever those losers are. And then they start talking about, well, the crowd didn't really sound that loud. And I'm like, were we at the same show? I heard a lot of crowd noise, Sorg.
Then again, we
that
had
crowd
like
– was insane at the beginning of the match. Did you hear them during the opening main event match, the opening match that they taped for main event? Summer Rae and Natalya, and they blew the roof off the
arena. They actually did.
And Natalya.
And also, you know, were we really here in the crowd, or is it just the two rows behind us screaming? Because I had a little bit of that I couldn't hear people on the microphone over that.
I think maybe being on the upper deck like you get the sound of the crowd kind of comes up to you. But because of the acoustics in the console arena and a lot of newer arenas, it seems like we just don't get that nice reverberation that really kind of amps up the sound anymore whenever we're cheering.
Well, let's talk
a bigger problem.
Let's talk about this, because I know we had this discussion because a weird thing happened. So you guys saw the Roman Reigns thing. I know you guys talked about on Raw Wrap-Up last night how, like, well, everybody was booing him, you know, and everybody was whatever. But a weird thing happened. I know you guys didn't get to see this, but so we got to the point where they're fighting in the back, and we're all watching it on the big screens, and, the, you know, 15,000 people freaking watching it on giant screens, right? That's what we got to, and I'm blocking because the light is shining up from the lighting rig that they have above the ring. Like, for some reason, it's shining towards us up in the cheap seats, so I can barely see it. So I'm holding my hand up, trying to see the video on the you know, screen in the middle, and then, like, it went off, and everybody started applauding. And I'm not entirely sure what were we applauding that Roman Reigns was gone from the screen. Or were we applauding everything that transpired with Roman Reigns?
We were cheering violence.
Everybody was just like, yeah, violence at that point?
Yeah, we were cheering violence. Because it got completely out of hand. And it's always fun when Mark Henry has to step in and be like, be cool, you know? That's when you know it's gone too far. And I think people were just cheering violence. They were not cheering Roman, that's for sure.
No.
I thought Pittsburgh was going to be cool. Pittsburgh, I thought we were going to be cool with Roman. You know, we were kind of in the get-along gang last time they were in town.
Yeah.
Sheamus was still the champ. Yeah. We wanted Roman to win. I thought Roman was going to win the title that night. And
yeah.
I thought the crowd was ready for it. Tonight, man, they were in there booing. There was You Can't Wrestle.
Mm-hmm.
There was
I thought you guys were just cheering because Roman was not in your peripheral anymore.
No, that was like an applause for like, yay, that was a fun segment. Good job.
Yeah.
Like the same way that like we applauded after the Social Outcasts did their spot for the hot dogs. Like they did it and like everyone's like, ha ha ha. And there's like this little smattering of applause because we were just like, ah, very amusing, you know? That's what it was.
Like Pittsburgh is equal parts ruthless and pleasant. I mean, I knew we were going to be in trouble because they played the tap out commercial at one point, and they were booing the tap out commercial when Roman came up. And I'm like, if he returns tonight, it is going to be unglued bad when he walks out here.
Okay, I have a legitimate question.
Mm-hmm.
Who do you think would get louder boos at this point? Roman Reigns punching Triple H or Eva Marie just standing there?
Mm-hmm.
I'm thinking Roman.
I'm thinking Roman too, because I think if you just sent Eva Marie out there, I think people would be – they might boo her, but there'd be that kind of like ironic, yay, she's here kind of thing too, you know? Whenever you see somebody that you haven't seen for a while on the main roster, you get excited. So
people wouldn't have been excited. Unless it's Roman.
Well, everybody knew where he was.
Yeah, everybody knew what was happening there. Although it was funny, I don't know if you noticed this, but when Roman's entrance music hit, and of course they went and looked, even I saw ushers checking to see if he was coming through. Up there on the upper level. Like, no, I think they were just confused because I think it's like the people like know that they get the heads up when he comes out, and I think there was just a bunch of ushers at the top of there saying, "Oh fuck, nobody told me about this. What's going on? Where is he?"
You know? Yeah.
Like I think they got swapped up by that too, to a certain extent. And I thought it was kind of interesting. So,
do you think that was the end of the entrance from the crowd for Roman? You think that was he's going to do the ramp from now on?
It should be, but it's not going to be.
Yeah, I think it should be too. Like, I think we're at that point. Like that.
He needs to stop cosplaying as the Shield.
Yeah, he does. Maybe get some new music. Maybe
some new colors.
No,
get someone to remix it. Maybe, I don't know.
Oh, there you go. Somebody called Basic Sickness. There you go. But
he should, for full on hatred, he should just come out to a Flo Rida song.
I wouldn't complain.
Or Machine Gun Kelly. Just one of them.
Nobody comes out the Machine Gun
Florida
Kelly.
Georgia Line.
No, no.
Not bad. He is from Florida, near the Georgia Line.
As I like to call it, the Flag-a-Line.
Very nice.
Country
Very
Samoan. Nice. That could be. I can't go anywhere from there. All right, we're going to get back. We're going to talk about injuries here in a moment, and anything else we have thoughts of the year. I mean, it's really, it's all WrestleMania. I mean, is there, I mean, you guys are covering everything else on the midweek war and everything. It's all about the lead up to WrestleMania. Listen, this is the big thing going into things. Hey, but in the meantime, you know what? It's a big thing around here. We get pizza here in studio. Matt Carnes has had some of it. Mad Mike has had some of it. We're going to fax some to Alex Carnes out there in California.
There you are.
There you go. We're working on that technology. There's plenty of technological startups here in Pittsburgh, and one of them I know is working on faxing that pizza. Slice on Broadway, our good friends over there, up here on in the South Hills of Pittsburgh, or down in Carnegie, PA, or opening here very shortly in PNC Park, the home of the Pittsburgh Pirates. There you go. That's the mayhem bump if I've ever heard one. Go check them out. If you're in the area, drop in, say hi. They greeted me at the door with my pizza. That is amazing. They saw my car pulling up. These guys are great. These guys are great. If you're a regular, they notice. But SliceOnBroadway.com. Check out PGH_Slice on the Twitters and Slice on Broadway on Facebook and on the Instagram. They're supporting Pittsburgh podcasting with the perfect pepperoni pizza now at the PNC Park with the Pittsburgh Pirates very shortly. So go check them out and let them know you heard about them on the Wrestling Mayhem Show. So, injuries. Sorgatron. Injuries, yes.
Can I interject one more note about Raw from Monday?
Okay,
night?
Go for it.
Just wanted to say, someone reminded me in the chat room, Jack Swagger failed his country on Monday because the League of Nations were doing a 4-on-3 beatdown on the New Day, which was screaming for someone to come to the rescue. And who else to save a trio from a gang of angry Euros than the All-American American? And where was he, Sorg? Apparently just chilling in the backstage, waiting with Mark Henry doing nothing. Come on, Swags. Am I the only one who feels this way? Am I here on the island? I mean, I'm all right with that. Not the first time.
I mean, I don't think Jack Swagger, he knows he wouldn't have been saved if that was him out there.
Next week, 4-on-1 beatdown of Jack Swagger, by the way.
He's hoping. Sure.
No one comes to his rescue.
He's in the rotation. Was he out injured or just gone?
Well, it's because they also had a split shift staff for Roadblock.
Mm-hmm.
So I think they're like, who can make Jericho look good? I know, Swagger.
Right, he was just the one. Because I was wondering about, because it did very much look like, this is a house show we converted, right? Like even more show than pulling our resources and doing Elimination Chamber. Wasn't there also a house show during Elimination Chamber when that dropped?
Yeah, I believe so.
So, I mean, and that's why you see, like, kind of these kind of odd shifts and everything. Well, there was some more bad news. The injury bug hit again. I don't know. We didn't really notice. We're just like, wow, that was really awkward. And just thought that's how the segment went. But, of course, poor Neville. Holy crap. Have you guys seen the video from this?
Yeah.
They posted the video of basically, like, when they were looking at his ankle. So Neville, of course, had a match with Chris Jericho. It got weird and kind of cut short. You guys were telling me about before the show. I want to talk about some of the referee controversy around that as well. Neville, they said that I'm amazed. I'm kind of surprised they did this. They just had a camera in the locker room when they were first checking out his boot. Trying to take his boot off and everything, right? And Eamon said it right. It's like the look on his face when they told him, it's broken, is just sad. It breaks your heart. Absolutely there. But you can check that over on WWE.com. And I know there's some stills about like what his ankle did and what Matt, was that you that pointed out like of all the things he does and sliding between Jericho's legs, apparently is the thing that did it.
Is it? That's always the way it happens. You do all your flippy stuff, and then you go to do a baseball slide, and you wreck yourself. But apparently, someone mentioned to me that you guys remember. Check yourself. if you remember way back to the glory days, well, not really, but the dying last days of ECW, apparently Rob Van Dam injured himself almost the exact same way and did some damage to his leg. doing a baseball slide. I guess it's not as easy as it looks, Sorg. I guess this is kind of a dangerous maneuver because of the canvas and the footwear. Sometimes you can get caught and you can get yourself, if you get too much grip on the canvas when you're sliding, mm-hmm. your momentum can kind of wreck you.
That's what I always worry about with guys like him and that slide into the ring the way they do, like full speed and then right there between the bottom rope and the apron. Like every time that happens, like and I take notice of it, I think back to is like, man, I remember when Vince McMahon botched that and blew out like both his knees. Right?
Yeah.
And it takes just, one misstep on that, one minor miscalculation. Which is why these guys are the athletes they are, right? It is actually funny, Matt. I was noticing in that match, I kind of remember back like early days of Daniel Bryan in WWE. And remember, he would go up on the rope and do this kind of backflip thing over somebody, right? Like he would climb turnbuckles and do a flip backwards. And sometimes it wasn't terribly crisp. And it feels like Neville is, and I was really kind of thinking about like, what is about Neville that he seems like very on? Like he doesn't seem to miss that, right? Like he's a little more precise. And then this happened. So I'm sorry, Neville, for not doubting you, I guess. But no, that's really sad. And he was online to be in a three-way with Owens and Sami Zayn, right? Like that was going to happen that we know of, right?
People think there's going to be a big multi-man. There may be like four or five, six guys,
Mm-hmm.
All it does is brings back memories of my boy Wade Barrett. He got hurt right before WrestleMania one time. I think he was in line for Money in the Bank that year, Sorg. But
now I have a question.
What?
With Neville's injury, do you think they may just move this to a straight up one-on-one match now with Zayn and Owens, and then put the rest of the guys they planned in the Battle Royal?
I don't know if they've. I don't know.
Because honestly, it might be a blessing in disguise.
I don't know. I don't know. That's asking a lot. Especially for. I mean, Sammy just showed up on the main roster.
Yeah, so did AJ. He's getting a one on one match.
Yeah, but.
If he's not going one on one against Jericho, I'll eat my hat.
Yeah, but AJ.
Who do you think came in with more casual WWE fan awareness when they debuted, Styles or Zayn? Like, who did more casual WWE fans?
Are you talking into NXT?
Look at him and say, "Oh, it's him."
Well,
who do you think was more well known to them?
Which Sami Zayn appearance are you talking about? Are you talking about his one against John Cena, his appearance in the Rumble, or
the actual main roster debut?
Then Sami.
Well, I mean, like the first time he showed up on Raw, then.
Oh.
When he wrestled Cena, right? No, actually, it was a tag match before that. Whatever. I'm killing my argument. I'm just wondering, like, you get where I'm going at with this, though.
Still, it's all a matter of location. Like, I'm discounting that whole tag team match that was the build-up because that wasn't handled well. Just like Charlotte didn't have that match against Natty.
Mm-hmm. No, that never happened.
But the Sami Zayn match against Cena was in Canada. He was introduced by Bret Hart. Like, people knew who Sami Zayn was there because he's Canadian. AJ Styles was brought into Florida, where the Impact Zone lives.
Yeah.
People knew who AJ Styles was there.
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, I would say based on those two, probably AJ. But if you put them in a vacuum, I'd say Sami.
Sami and Owens have all this history that they could build an amazing story around, but it just doesn't feel like they're very interested in telling the story of Owens like killing Sammy and putting him on the shelf and basically putting his career on pause for however many months he was out.
Matt Carlins clearly doesn't watch SmackDown.
No, I don't. It doesn't count.
I was going to say, I thought that
was literally all about everything you just said.
Yeah.
Well, you know what? Well, there wasn't a hint of it on Raw, and about 1.5 million more people watch Raw every week. So,
well, that's the problem.
It seems like that's something that they need to. Yeah.
I don't think it's that far off anymore. If you look at the ratings, it's pretty. The ratings are kind of close, which are scary.
Has it?
Yeah.
Just throwing that out there. Also, yeah. Apparently, it was a night for cameras to be right back there with injuries, because they also threw one back there with Triple H's bloody back of the head from that brawl that we talked about a little bit earlier. And yeah, that's no, he got cut. He got cut pretty good. Yeah, my guess is from when he was throwing stuff around around the production over by the stage. That's what it seemed to be when I was looking back at the clip actually earlier. So, yeah, interesting night in Pittsburgh to say the least. Either way, anything else you guys want to touch on about this? Matt, do you have any other kind of observations from the live crowd that we attended? Because I mean, that's always interesting to kind of see. This is probably the show where I least paid attention to production.
Yeah, I think the only time I really paid attention to production was when they were doing Undertaker's entrance, just because I was interested to see how they kind of set that thing up. But I never knew they used the big boom rig camera to get them doing the lights up move. At any rate, this is insane because I've been a wrestling fan for 30 plus years. But last night was my first time ever seeing Undertaker live, period. I'd never seen Undertaker live before.
Wow.
My first time ever seeing Triple H make his entrance for a match live. I'd seen him do his authority bit. I'd never seen Triple H enter the arena to have a match live. Here comes time to play the game. I'd never seen it before. It was awesome.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, that's awesome. Crazy.
I love that these are all the things that you could have potentially have seen 10 to 15 years ago.
Too.
like every one of those things.
Low.
Yeah, yeah.
I wasn't a lapsed fan or anything. I just was not a really live event kind of guy for a long time. And yeah, I really have only really started to go to like Raws and things like that very recently.
Wow.
It's also much easier to get live tickets now.
Is it?
Yeah.
Has it?
Internet. Internet. Come on, Sorg.
Wait, how did you 10, used 15 to?
15 years ago, you had to go wait online or call a Ticketmaster broker.
Or go to
the supermarket.
I believe for us, it was go to drive to the mall half an hour away and go to the JCPenney's to find the Ticketmaster outlet.
Your National Record Mart. Yeah. If you live in Pittsburgh.
Nope, we didn't have National Record Mart. Nope. It was where did they put the Ticketmaster? Oh, it's this weird place over here by the lingerie, right? Okay, let's get tickets for Marilyn Manson and WWE. Yeah. Excuse me, Insane Clown Posse? No? Trust me, they're... Okay, anyways. So...
Check under I for insane?
Yes.
No?
Make sure... In that case, make sure you're wearing the t-shirt of the band you're going to see, you know, in the lingerie department of JCPenney, so they know what you're talking about.
So you're like these guys right here.
Yeah, these guys right here. Do you want to get a ticket too? Do you want to? We could be my date. No.
Okay. You want to go?
Yeah. You don't know this. Anyways, let us know your thoughts and everything. Thank you, everybody in the chat room, hanging out. Tragar used to have to go to JCPenney's. Tragar knows what I'm talking about. Yeah.
Oh, those JCPenney tickets, man. The lines were around the block.
I mean, it was Kaufman.
Dude, those lines went all the way down past the bathrooms into young men's section. And boy, the weirdos you saw in that section, they should not have been there.
You should see the Kaufman.
What are you doing in petites? I'm waiting for my Insane Clown Posse tickets, of course.
Yeah. What are you doing in petites?
The line always went right to the Hanes Cross Her Heart Draining Bra section, and that's where everyone just got really awkward.
Nobody wants to be there.
And no one, and then like we didn't have smartphones then, so we couldn't pretend we were playing Angry Birds the whole time. We were waiting online too. We're just sitting there like,
just standing there.
Calls me. Hope someone calls me while I'm online.
Who's on the packaging for the training bra?
Hands in your pocket. Just looking around.
See, the only JCPenney memories I have are the old Christmas catalogs. That's it. Maybe going once or twice. So
the ones that were like 3 inches thick, those ones?
Yes.
Yeah.
Wasn't that the Sears Wish Book, you guys? Not the JCPenney one?
They both had one for a while.
Why not both?
Okay. It was probably Penny's too.
What the hell?
They sent you a telephone book for Christmas to order out of.
That's right. All that paper. But it was way more interesting than the telephone book. But
in my day.
That's what it looks like when you have all the G.I. Joes. Okay. Anyways. We don't have hey guys, why don't you go visit the Sears catalog of indie wrestling over at indiewrestling.us. It's got some great stuff over there, a great column by Matt Carlins himself. recapping the weekend in indie wrestling. And of course, we got some great stuff over there from our friends at International Wrestling Cartel, Renegade Wrestling Alliance, Vicious Outcast Wrestling, Legend of Virgil, and all the like.
How about that IWC show on how Saturday about night for
IWC show? Actually, I don't think I properly listed.
Someone knows what to do with them.
You can go check out IWC 15. It's actually available now over here. Did I link it? There it is. Colt Cabana was part of this. DJ Z against Jimmy Nuts for the IWC heavyweight title. The ending will shock you. It shocked me, and I was there live switching it. Dave Crist, Gory, Pedro. Nobody else is going to care about this except for us, but Pedro was back talking about the cache. And it was a great, great, awesome night. There is a moment where somebody took a scissor lift to the ring and jumped off it into the ring.
Oh, yeah.
Who is it? You'll have to get the DVD to find out, or wait till I finally get that clip online. So go check it out. IndieWrestling.us, IWCWrestling.com, IWC 15, IWC's Proving Grounds 5. Very shortly, sooner or later, when I get to it, RWA Fury 5 will be up as well. So freshly edited, got about half edited at this point. Look out for all that stuff. IndieWrestling.us. Sign up, you get a free wrestling show. Who's on that wrestling show? I don't remember. I'm pretty sure AJ Styles is a part of that. Christopher Daniels, all kinds of cool people, and of course the stars of the IWC. So we're gonna go check out some more from our 10-year party at Looking for Group this past January. And we'll be right back with a big question. Something very special coming up on WrestlingMayhemShow.com and what you've been waiting for, the Patreon in the Bank edition of Mayhem Mania. We'll be right back.
I started as just a fan. I started a couple years back as a fan, and then I started emailing the show, and then while I was emailing the show, they had this little orientation type situation where they actually asked people to be on the actual Mayhem show. So, and I think my first episode was the Butterbean SJK confrontation. I'm not sure why I was on there, but it was a lot of fun to be on there.
We're back, Wrestling Mayhem Show. Check out all those videos at the 10-year playlist over on the YouTube page, and we got a few over at the Facebook for Wrestling Mayhem Show as well. All right, hey, before we get to the big question, I want to give a shout-out. We got something coming up here, another kind of thought experiment, and the idea, we're going to do March Mayhem. Everybody's getting bracket crazy here with March Madness, and so we're doing a little bit of experiment. I don't know how it's going to go. I don't know if you guys are going to dig it, but we're giving it a shot. So you'll see a link on the website here in the coming days where there is this wonderful bracket. Big props to Riz, by the way, for setting this up. There's a bracket, and we're going to determine the best match ever, determined partially by the Mayhemers here and by you guys out there as well through voting. So the idea is, we set up some brackets. What was it? We did one championship match, one mid card, one wild card, and one other match.
And one non-title match
specifically. And amongst six of us here at the Wrestling Mayhem Show, and we have a bracket together of you know, basically we go through and tell us which of the two matches from bracket to bracket that you think win. It's going to be a voting system, and like I said, look for that here on our Facebook, on our Twitter, on our WrestlingMayhemShow.com, and join us for the March Mayhem, and maybe we'll see how that goes through and see if it gets quite as heated as Mayhem Mania probably will here in a few minutes. But first, Matt and Mike, we have a big question to get to.
I do. Matt Collins is going to ask the question, but I'm going to phrase how this question came up. So last night I was watching Raw, as I'm wont to do on Monday nights, and my friend Jen is on Twitter, and she watched wrestling back in the late 90s and early 2000s. I'm not sure if I would technically qualify her as a fan, but I know she likes to tweet about it occasionally. And this all came up when she was surprised that Chris Jericho was still wrestling. Mm-hmm. And she began to, by the way, if you want to follow her on Twitter, her Twitter handle is at OMG. It's Jen. Jen, I apologize for all the weirdo followers you would get who will listen to this show. Anyway, basically, after that, the Jericho conversation, she started to ask me about all the wrestlers that she knew of back when she watched. And pretty much every single one of them she asked me about, I said, yep, he still wrestles. He still wrestles. They still wrestle. Like, she asked me about Tommy Dreamer, about Triple H, and she loves The Rock. So I was like, I'm like, oh, you should watch WrestleMania. The Rock's going to be there. What he's doing, we don't know. She asked me about the Hardy Boys. So I showed her a picture of baby Maxwell, who she thought was very cute. And she thought Matt Hardy looked 9,000 years old. So you can tell that's why we're friends. But yeah, it led to a really kind of, like, it got a little dark when she started asking about Mike Awesome, but we won't get into that. But it kind of led into what we wanted to discuss for the big question this week. And Matt, I believe you phrased it better than I did.
Yeah, I think the big question is, why do we still need all these old wrestlers?
Yeah, it makes sense.
And I want you to really think about it, like, because there is a reason. It's because we don't have any new wrestlers. That's why we still need the old ones.
Well, here's the thing.
What the hell happened?
So here's the thing that I'm thinking. If we're talking about the previous generation and the people that were big in the previous generation, right? You know, who was main eventing? Oh, this is going to get really sad, actually, now that I think about it. Who was main eventing 10 years ago at this point? So we're talking 2005, right? You had comebacks of some people that are around now, right? I know Shawn Michaels, Ric Flair finally retired. We have a rash of injuries, of course, this year. But still, in the meantime, you have guys that probably would still be relevant and would still be probably wrestling in Undertaker age and Triple H age if they didn't get neck injuries and concussions. I'm talking about Daniel Bryan. I'm talking about Edge. And hell, even Christian to a point, right? Or you know, think about some other, unfortunately, some that have passed, like Eddie Guerrero. You don't
throw
those
guys in there.
You can
throw other guys in there. You can throw guys like Test,
right?
You know?
Right.
If Test, you know, there are a lot of guys like, you know, and maybe we're making assumptions. I don't want to make assumptions about people who are dead, but you know, guys who maybe if they're a little bit luckier in their health, or maybe taken better care of themselves or avoided certain pitfalls that come upon anybody in all sorts of fields, that we could still have some of these guys around to still have awesome matches.
Mm-hmm. I mean, and I think to a point you do have, I feel like Jericho's from that generation. I feel like Jericho's from that Eddie Guerrero, Benoit, Dean Malenko generation, right? And obviously he is still out there and he is still super relevant, I feel.
But the thing with Jericho is, mm-hmm, he's taken a lot of time off.
Yes.
He's pursued other ventures. Like, I think that has a lot to do with it. Like, the reason Batista isn't wrestling right now is because he's a giant movie star.
Mm-hmm.
The same with The Rock. Mm-hmm. Like, there are guys who have just left to do other things.
And I think
Jericho's also kind of a freak in a way. I mean, he doesn't get hurt. He's been extremely fortunate over his career. Dude does not get injured for mm-hmm one whatever reason.
Super cautious in the ring, I suppose. But no, I think that's the other thing too, is there are other options and people are taking on those other options, right? You know, even looking at something with somebody like Edge, who is doing something different, you know, outside of his injury, or you know, you can't think that Stone Cold wouldn't be around in some vein right now if he didn't get injured, right?
Especially with this WrestleMania in Texas.
Right, right. Yeah. I can't imagine you won't see Stone Cold at WrestleMania, right? And now I get that maybe Rock being advertised is more of a big deal since he's Mr. Fast and the Furious movie star or whatever, right? But you can't
Although
tell
Rock's
me.
Rock's been like the past five WrestleManias. So
yeah, exactly.
I don't know if it's really that big of a deal anymore.
Exactly, but still, I wouldn't even be surprised if like maybe a week before we do get a rumbling, hey, Stone Cold will be there. It's not like Stone Cold isn't around. He's obviously actively doing things as far as the podcast goes, and that's about it, of course. Or they used to truck him out for the Legends kind of open you know, the legend things they used to do when they had the random 3-hour Raws instead of like every week, or the old Raw old schools or anything like that. No, I think it is just the nexus of the rash of injuries, rash of other opportunities, and did we really build anybody as big as that flux of people that we had then? And plus other opportunities in the fact that we have the Hardy Boys that are, have been everywhere but WWE for the past 5 years, right? Like, what would they be doing if they were around? You know, maybe Jeff Hardy would be an even bigger star if he stuck around instead of taking a powder after the CM Punk feud. Or CM Punk. That situation. Sorry, Pittsburgh says they're sorry.
I mean, you know, Kurt Angle. I mean,
yeah,
we know the reason that he left was he's partially health-related and maybe extended his career by a good long while by going to TNA. Rob Van Dam, you know, he had a lot of mileage left on him for whatever reason, just decided that it wasn't worth it to go through that grind anymore, take the lighter schedule. I mean, TNA, how much responsibility does TNA take for throwing money at these guys to work less dates in relative obscurity?
In their backyard. Kind of
staying away from us for a decade, you know?
ED.
Yeah, exactly, RVD.
Mm-hmm. I mean, Hulk Hogan, too.
And that TNA was relatively in the retirement home backyard of all these guys in Florida.
This is true.
I mean, let's think about this. It's like, oh, come on, work TNA. We film once a month, have a smattering of live shows that you probably won't come to anyways, and we're in Orlando. You're also probably in the greater Florida area. That's not so bad versus if WWE, right?
Exactly.
Because, so, I mean, what's the thing everybody complains about? That road schedule and
the travel and the toll. Exactly.
It's almost like if WWE did less road dates, maybe everyone will be a lot healthier,
which you do get, but you also get guys like Brock Lesnar coming in and doing minimal dates, guys like Jericho coming in and doing just a smattering of dates. Like, I think I don't know if that contributes, but I think that the more that happens and the more you move your Randy Orton's and John Cena's to a schedule like that, the longer they'll be around, right?
But at the same time, do we want them around longer? Because that kind of just perpetuates the problem. Like, all right, my friend Jen...
There's a big difference right now between a guy like Randy Orton, who is still in his prime, and Chris Jericho and Undertaker and Triple H and those guys who are clearly past their prime, still have a lot to offer. But are those the guys you want on top? Let's flip it to New Japan real quick, where you'll see, you know, a lot. They'll put a lot of their, you know, legendary guys in, you know, multi-man tag matches just to kind of like, you know, in the opener. They'll send Jushin Thunder Liger out in the opener because dude can't work a one-on-one match, you know, every single night anymore. But, you know, people like to see him. So ideally, is that what... You know, it sounds insane.
No.
But, you know, is that what these, you know, older guys should be used for? Put them in some, you know, put them in some opening tag matches. Let them groom the younger guys, you know, stuff like that.
Well, I think you also
John Cena in the U.S. title.
Okay.
That's good booking.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
That was good booking. You allowed Seth Rollins, a new star, to be the top guy. He's still got overshadowed by Cena at points, but Cena was out of the main event scene, and the product was better as a whole for it. Like, my friend Jen is listening live, and she said that, like, as an answer to the question, is that the guys from 10 years ago are awesome, and that's because wrestling was a lot more popular back then. Like she's a casual fan now. She watches occasionally. She thinks the guys that they're trotting out now, like Sheamus and Roman Reigns, would get their asses handed to them by like guys like The Rock and Triple H back then and stuff like that. Like, and she's not wrong. Mm-hmm. WWE is not building stars because they're resting on the laurels of the guys that were big 10, 15, 20 years ago.
I think that's important because you say, wow, this guy's on top. You got to think like WCW, we had guys on top like Hulk Hogan, which couldn't turn in a good match to save his life, right? Versus... Now we have, well, actually, in the long run, Triple H and Undertaker can still go, right? I mean, still, like, in a lot of aspects, these guys that are in their 40s can outwork half the guys on the roster that are in the 20s. That's the problem. I think
Ric Flair could outwork people well into his upper 40s, you know, and, you know, he's the exception to the rule. I mean, that's, you know, Jericho and Triple H are,
right,
anomalies.
All right, we're losing you a little bit there, Matt. But I don't know if it's something with your network or
little
whatnot.
A little bit robot-y. But yeah, I mean, like, I don't know if it's necessarily true that Taker and all those guys can outwork some of the younger guys.
Mm-hmm.
I think the younger guys need to be given that chance to be put on that big pedestal. Because if you watch The Undertaker when he was the same age as these guys, he couldn't work as well as he can now.
No. Well, he didn't have to because he had Hulk Hogan and the Warrior.
It's all time and opportunity. Like, and we've had guys who were able to take the mantle at one point, and the trigger was never pulled on them.
Mm-hmm.
Like, Carlito was a guy that would have been really fun, like mid-2000s, that could have been pushed. I remember going to New Year's Revolution with the Elimination Chamber. Carlito and Chris Masters trucked Kane, Kurt Angle, John Cena, and Shawn Michaels. If it wasn't for Cena, you know, being John Cena at the end of the match, Chris Masters and Carlito were legitimate dudes. They were legitimate in that fight, and they trucked everyone else in that match.
Mm-hmm.
There's a gap. There's like a lost generation, and like guys like, I know you guys don't want to hear this, but like Mr. Kennedy is part of it. Carlito, Shelton Benjamin, I'm trying to think of guys. John Morrison, a great example of someone who left.
Exactly. So again, some weird stuff.
McIntyre, Jesus, you know.
Yeah.
Those guys were there. They weren't developed. They moved on. And they missed the train on these guys. I mean, maybe they'll come back. It'd be nice to think about that they might come back. And
I love that Matt sounds
a
like
a lot of these guys are like, worthless. Matt, terrible. I apologize to everybody. I didn't mean to say worthless.
Matt, you sound like a bad auto tune. I'm sorry.
Matt's using his funny whistle.
I don't know what's going on with that.
Matt is channeling Carly Rae Jepsen.
Try to bounce out and back into the hangout. It probably needs corrected right there. We got some other voices on here. I want to get some quick opinions before we get to the Mayhem Mania, and hopefully Matt's internet kicks back in. Bobby FJ Town, I know you're in here with us. You popped in here. Hi, you're just hanging out. You got nowhere else to be.
I was gonna say, look over Matt's shoulder, but since he's not here, half of our card that are the qualified matches are future, hopefully future stars if they don't drop the ball with them.
Right.
We got Kevin Owens, Sami Zayn, Finn Balor. You know, they're all on that board for a reason. That's who we all want to see. That's who hopefully they don't drop the ball on for the future. You know, I'm hoping they can build those guys up.
But can someone really drop the ball if they're only holding it until someone passes it back to, like, a John Cena? Like, there's a reason that with Roman Reigns not working, that they defaulted to Triple H. They had other options, but they feel that using, like, nostalgia is a better way to go than trying to, say, push a Dean Ambrose.
Yeah.
As with any company, they're going to go, especially a company this size, they're going to go with the safe bet. They're always going to go with the safe bet. You see the same thing with movie companies, and this is an entertainment company. So you're only as good as your last buy, or you're only as good as your last match, or whatever, however you want to say it. You look at Ryan Reynolds was absolutely wrecked as a movie star after Green Lantern, right? Not his fault. Not his fault at all. And now Deadpool brings him back. So what is it? You know, maybe it's something with these guys. Alex, I think you're back. I want to get an opinion from you if you have one on this question as well.
Yeah, sure. So I just want to clarify. So the question is, why do we need these guys from 10 years ago, right?
Yeah.
Right. Well, I think the short answer is that indoor attendance record ain't going to break itself. I mean, especially when you consider we're in WrestleMania season, this is usually the time that they will pull out all the stops. And I mean, we've kind of seen it in the past, you know, I would say at least the past 5 years where they've relied on their stars from like the Attitude Era and maybe even before that in order to try to make the WrestleMania card look all the better. I mean, you know, they'll do just about anything. They'll put in the celebrity, they'll put the celebrities into the matches. They'll do a gimmick battle royal. They'll do, you know, they'll literally do just about anything to make the WrestleMania card something that everybody wants to watch. Mm-hmm. So I think it just kind of comes down to like, I mean, and you know, with the injury situation looking like it is, I mean, it just kind of adds to that whole thing.
Certainly. Certainly. Matt,
I think WrestleMania sells itself though, because you have people buying tickets for that, not knowing what the main event is 6 months prior. Mm-hmm. Like, I mean, they're already selling ticket packages for SummerSlam. Do we know what the main event of SummerSlam is? No, but are people going to sell it out anyway? Absolutely they are.
It'll probably be something to do with Triple H and Roman Reigns.
I'll take that bet. I will take that bet.
All right.
Triple H will be nowhere near that main event.
Matt, do you have any last thoughts? And I kind of want to test to make sure your connection's working.
Yeah, how am I doing now? Am I doing better?
Yeah, it's a lot better. I think it just got kind of jacked up on the internet there.
The scope of this conversation is immense. Somebody just mentioned something in the chat.
I'll read that here in the chat.
I just wanted to say real quick that we were talking about WrestleMania. The last time, and you guys correct me if I'm wrong, but I'm going from memory. Last time WWE went all the way with a couple young stars at WrestleMania was Cena and Batista at WrestleMania 21. It wasn't a big arena show. It was at a smaller venue. They could afford to take the risk. Mm-hmm. The scope of WrestleMania is almost acting against the opportunity for younger guys to get that chance because the pressure is so great to pack that huge venue. They have to go with a proven guy so that they can fill that stadium. If they don't get 85,000 people into Cowboys Stadium, it's going to look ridiculous. Mm-hmm. It's going to look empty.
It's going to look like the old baseball stadium.
That might be an exaggeration.
They get 85,000 in Cowboys Stadium, that's a fucking failure. That place can hold over 107.
Yeah.
Like, and that's about what it was for New York at MetLife, right?
No.
70-some?
Yeah, MetLife was like 70, 80, something like that.
Yeah. All right. With that, I think it's time. No more stalling.
Oh, baby. Oh,
we do have a comment from Chad.
Oh, I'm sorry. I'm so sorry. Yeah, we do have a comment. From Tragar. I got you. I think it goes to these new guys never had to grind it out, sharing cars and hotel rooms and outright slumming it just for the love of the business, never had to write their own promos. As the product gets more and more scripted, the newer wrestlers inexperienced in life is showing whenever audibles are needed. You could say that's
piggybacking off of that,
yeah,
they don't know the current generation in WWE. They don't know how to protect their own characters. Mm-hmm. Steve Austin would go home if he didn't like what they were doing with his character. Shawn Michaels would refuse to do a job. Bret Hart would whine and complain. These guys would kvetch and whine and threaten and do whatever it took to protect themselves, to protect them, their brand, because they knew their living depended on them being treated correctly, and no one else is going to look out for them except for them. And now you've got guys just coming to work, you know, do my thing, putting too much trust in the people who are in charge when they need to be paying more attention to their own best interests.
Look at Matt, you also have to
remember though, this generation also has to deal with social media. Mm-hmm. And they kind of have to be their gimmick almost 24/7.
I disagree. You know what I mean? I don't think very few people are their gimmick 24/7.
I don't think that connects with that point. I think it's a thing to think about, but I don't think that's a factor leading to our overall discussion.
I mean, I'm just like,
it's not a non-factor.
If Austin showed up and he had Twitter on the day that he was booked against Brock Lesnar of no build, he would have angry Twitter stream.
Oh, yeah.
As opposed to just walking. You know what I mean?
Austin Twitter during the Attitude Era would have been pretty awesome. Because I believe Austin would have used it the right way.
We should make
fake Attitude Era Twitter accounts.
Oh, I don't have time for that. I just started a Tumblr, man. Let me live.
should we plug that before we go on?
It's not ready yet. Soon.
Soon, my minion. Yeah, we still need to work on it. If you keep an eye out to some of the Wrestling Mayhem Show's social media, you're going to find this Tumblr. This is the next big thing. I think it might be the next big thing. So next big project.
Brock Lesnar Tumblr.
This is what happens.
The Brock Lesnar of Tumblrs. Exactly.
This is what happens when myself and Carlins get stuck in a car for 3 hours to Columbus.
It did happen.
Tumblrs get started. But anyways, it's time, finally.
That's where Tumblrs come from.
Trip to Columbus. What do we get next year when we go to the Arnold? It's time for Mayhem Mania.
That's right, friends. It's time for Mayhem Mania Patreon in the Bank round. It's kind of a competitive thought experiment where the goal is to create the best WrestleMania card possible within the realm of the current reality. That means everyone we're using comes in their current physical, emotional, and contractual state.
Except for Neville, who's already graduated to a supercard.
No, you are mistaken. Neville is not on the supercard. Basically, the goal is to get as many matches onto the supercard so we can fill up to 8 matches. So we've got 2 over there. We got there by the merit of having survived 3 rounds of Mayhem Mania without being altered, because every time we do a round of Mayhem Mania, people start effing around with the matches. That's kind of the game. So the goal is to make a match good enough that it will survive long enough to make it to the supercard. So the big board is back. No one will be able to read it, but it's okay. We're going to try our best. I'm going to kind of swing this bad boy around. Sorgy, you're going to tell me if I'm doing okay here.
Yeah, you're all right. All right, so far, I am going
to tell you what we're going to do. Mm-hmm. First things first, let's take a look. We got another match on the supercard right now. This is a hell of a thing, guys. I tell you what. All right.
You need a wider angle on that.
This is getting rough. All right, listen. It's unwieldy. All right. We've got 2 matches on the supercard. 2 matches have graduated. A new one just graduated after the round last week. Congratulations, Apollo Crews versus Brock Lesnar versus Bray Wyatt. You're on the supercard with Finn Balor and Kevin Owens versus Sami Zayn. I mean, Finn Balor versus Kevin Owens versus Sami Zayn. That's the match that should have had Neville in it. Boy, am I glad that worked out for the best for everybody. Okay.
That's what I was thinking Neville was in, actually. That's why.
You're right. It's the match he should have been in, and I don't know what the hell happened. We also have these other matches, these also-rans, and I'm going to run through them real quick just so everybody can hear the matches that we have left since last week. We have Jimmy Uso versus Jey Uso versus The Rock versus Nia Jax versus Roman Reigns. We have Blake and Murphy versus The Revival versus American Alpha. We have Darren Young versus Michael Tarver. We have Dean Ambrose versus Rusev. We've got Mojo Rawley with Rob Gronkowski in his corner versus Baron Corbin.
Yeah.
Yay, eat that food. All right. We have Shinsuke Nakamura versus AJ Styles. We have Alberto Del Rio versus Austin Aries. And we've got a blank space, baby, because one of our matches graduated after last week. Guess who created the match that graduated?
Ooh, I know.
Sorgatron created the match that graduated. Sorry, Mike. I knew you know. Sorg, you're going to get to create a brand new match. But first we're going to unleash the patrons. We've got 6 patrons playing tonight. Not all of them can be here to be with us tonight. But, you know, I really like to have everyone's input. So 3 of the patrons basically sent in their moves in advance. Those being AJ, Bo Diggity, Ed, and Antonio Garza. So here's basically what the kids are going to get to do, and what you, Alex, and you, Mad Mike, and you, Jennifer, from the Matthew and Jennifer Carlins for Podcast Betterment Foundation. I can't organize my thoughts. These are the things that you're going to get to do. You don't have to do all of them. You can pass if you want to, so no pressure to do all 5 things. But here's the dealie. First, you're going to get the, if you choose, fast track graduate a match from the undercard to the supercard. Basically, you get to skip go and go straight to jail, something like that. Number 2, and this is where it gets a little tricky, because usually when a match graduates, we let the person who created it create the match that replaces it. But because we had to do the Patreons in advance, I'm letting the Patreons create the match to fill the hole whenever they graduate the match. This is a week only, so that's kind of how we're filling the hole so that there's more stuff to play with. So you get to create the match. If you graduate a match, you get to create the match to fill the hole. You get to make your normal move. You add one wrestler, add one tag team to an existing match, or swap in the undercard. One match for one match, one guy for one guy, one team for one team, or everyone's favorite, kill and create. Kill a match entirely, create a brand new one with entirely new wrestlers. Also, number four, you get to do five things. I will help you out and walk you through the steps. Don't worry. Mike is giddy as a scoreboard right now.
I have my whole list.
Number four on the list of things you'll get to do, add a stipulation or a manager or a special referee or a title to one of these matches, etc. We just want to add a stipulation. And that applies to everything. You can even get after the supercard with that. And finally, just for fun, since it's been a theme for Mayhem Mania this year, if you choose, I want you guys to dig deep in your minds. And just for fun, I'd like for everyone to add a corporate sponsor to one of the matches whenever you're done, just as your last move. I know you guys could think of something. Right, Sorgi? So without further ado, let's see. We're going to do the first the patrons who can't be in attendance, and I'm going to reveal their moves to you. And I've got the big board in this turret configuration because hopefully this will make it very easy for all of us to do this. And I'm going to try to not drop stuff on my head. Anyway, we're going to start with Bo Diggity. First come, first served as far as the absentee patrons. So Bo Diggity, for his first move. Oh, let me mention one thing real quick. I'm sorry. I neglected my list. Okay. First of all, I have to mention one thing, and this will still apply to matches that graduate. If you create the match that graduates, you also get a little thing we call the Eliminator. It's basically you're earning the right to get rid of people you don't want to see in the card. So if someone – you can't eliminate someone that's on the card currently, but if someone gets moved off, you can eliminate them so that no one else can use them in this entire Mayhem Mania. So Eamon has earned an Eliminator. Sorg, you have an Eliminator. You can use that anytime you want. You could jump in whenever you want. But Eamon was tired of waiting, and Eamon decided who he wanted to eliminate. Anybody want to take a guess? Who Eamon has eliminated? Spoiler alert.
I know who it is, and it's a great choice.
Mr. What's-His-Face.
That's right. Eamon has eliminated, freshly released by TNA, Mr. Anderson, because the threat after 48 hours of Mr. Anderson being out there as a free agent, of him showing up at WrestleMania, is just too great. And yes, Eamon used the Eliminator on Mr. Anderson.
Yeah, I'm not going to lie, I would have booked him.
Did that come for Mr. Kennedy too?
Yes.
I didn't see that coming. Anyway, Sorg, you still have an Eliminator. Is there anyone you want to eliminate?
Not at this time, sir.
While we have you?
Not at this time, sir.
All right. Well, if you think of something, we'll get to that. I'm trying to keep things moving quickly, and we're going to move right into Bo Diggity's moves. And Bo Diggity's going to jump right into it. Very exciting because Bo Diggity's first move, he is indeed going to graduate a match. He's going to fast-track graduate a match from the undercard to the supercard, and Bo Diggity has decided to graduate. All right, I'm not going to drag you guys. He is graduating Shinsuke Nakamura versus AJ Styles to the supercard. So a very good move.
Good choice. Good choice.
By Bo Diggity. So now, Bo Diggity. This is getting rough. Okay. I got myself just a little more room. Okay. Now.
If only you had someone there who could hold the board for you.
If only I had someone here who could hold the board. I know. This is not working out for me. Sorg, this Max, is a damn mess. All right.
Question. Does that mean I get an eliminator now?
Yes, Bobby. Yes, you created the match. You get an eliminator. Is there? Would you like to use your eliminator?
Not ready at this time.
All right, good. Thank you for reminding me. Like I said, it's so hectic. And it's out of control today. Okay. Now, AJ had to create a match to fill the hole that he left over here. So AJ's, he's a free thinker, and he likes to come up with some really fresh ideas. So AJ's match that he chose to replace Nakamura versus Styles is an 8-man tag team match.
Oh, shit.
Awesome. Yeah. It's got pre-show written all over it. It's going to be the Social Outcasts, all four members of the Social Outcasts, versus Enzo Amore, Colin Cassidy, Ty Dillinger, and making his glorious return to the WWE, one of those lost generation folks, Vladimir Kozlov will be the fourth member of the team.
That's my favorite match ever now.
Sounds good to me.
I love it.
So yes,
I love it.
He's my great colleague.
You missed your chance to eliminate him, Bobby, so I bet you didn't see that one coming.
No, as far as Riz likes the great colleague, Vladimir Kozlov is my great colleague.
Bobby loved Vladimir Kozlov.
And he loved Double E.
Yes.
So I gave AJ the chance. I'm sorry, I keep calling him AJ. He's Bo Diggity. I don't know why I'm getting this wrong all the time. So I gave Bo Diggity the chance to... I said, Bo Diggity, you want to just make a move to the card? And he's like, nah, I don't want to do that. So I'm like, all right, how about a stipulation? And Bo Diggity came up with one hell of a stipulation. And Bo Diggity wants the stipulation to apply to this match that he created right here. His 8-man tag will be a family double dare obstacle course match. Winners get a 13-inch TV and a trip to space camp.
My favorite match of all time. Why can't this be on WrestleMania?
Wait, hold on. Is that also the sponsor? Is it sponsored by Family Double Dare?
Whenever I asked him for the sponsor, he just said see above. So I guess it's sponsored by Space Camp.
Sponsored by Mark Summers.
Sponsored by Mark Summers
and his whatever sneakers were that he wore all the time. I
guess technically it would be sponsored by the Food Network since he's in charge of that. But
God damn it, Bo Diggity.
Germophobia.
Bo Diggity has just won Mayhem Mania.
Bo Diggity is doing the Lord's work right here, folks. So, okay, so that's very exciting. So now we move on to our friend Ed.
Now, is Ed a real person? Because we've never heard him.
I've never heard of Ed. I've never met Ed, but Ed replies to my tweets. So Ed exists, I guess, more or less. So I asked Ed if he would like to graduate a match. And Ed said yes, he would like to graduate a match from the undercard. And Ed decided, this was kind of a surprise to me, folks, but Ed said he wanted to graduate the NXT three-way, Blake and Murphy versus the Rival versus...
Does that mean I get two?
That was the one I was going to graduate.
So, yes.
Eliminators?
Bobby created that match too. Bobby, you now have two eliminators.
Bobby, you can eliminate a tag team.
I can.
You can say, the Beverly Brothers are not getting booked.
I choose not to use it at this time.
That's good. That's convenient for me because it would be really inconvenient if we eliminate someone who is
already booked
on these moves that have already been made. Okay. So awkward. Okay, so Ed had to create a match. Ed decided to, I'll be honest, Ed played it safe here. And to create the whole, Ed has created a women's match. And Ed decided he wants to see Sasha versus Becky Lynch. So that's going to be the match that replaces that right up there. Okay, now, I said, Ed, do you want to make a standard move to the undercard? Ed said, yes. And Ed has decided to use his kill and create option. So Ed has decided to kill our favorite match, Mojo Rawley versus Baron Corbin with Rob. Sorry, everybody.
Damn it, that was going to be sponsored by Floam.
Definitely. Who?
By Floam. Nickelodeon Floam was going to sponsor that match.
Just
damn it.
Sponsor the other one. All right, so Mojo Rawley versus Baron Corbin has got to go. So we got to... What was that now? Just
poor Robert.
Over there next to the steps. All right, so and finally, we had to ask Ed... What else did we ask Ed here?
He's creating the match, okay. So
now he's going to make the stipulation. So now, Ed, do you want to do a stipulation? Why, yes, he does. And
Ed, did you say what match you replaced it with? Because you just put it on the board.
About that. Ed replaced the match with Asuka versus Natalya, which we had it on the board before, but now it's back. Did everybody get me on that? I didn't freeze right there?
Yeah, you're good.
Great. And then Ed decided to add a stipulation to the match that he created. So there's going to be a stipulation for Asuka versus Natalya because Ed wants to see women-on-women violence, and it's going to be a ladder match for the Divas title between Asuka and Natalya. Sounds good to me, so. Boom, there it goes, right there. All right, one more. And then the fun really begins. All right, now, Antonio Garza. Antonio Garza decided he wanted to graduate a match. And in true Garza fashion, he has decided that he wants to graduate the Samoan five-way.
Damn it!
The Usos and Nia Jax and The Rock versus, what's his name? Big Smooth, Roman Reigns. Yep, that's right.
Big Smooth. I don't know what we're talking about anymore. Wet hair Roman Reigns.
All right, so Garza needs to create a match to fill the... Oh, by the way, the match that Garza graduated, Sorg, you're going to have to call Stosh from Max out because he now has an eliminator.
That's awesome.
Can you get him on the horn? Just let him know, okay?
We'll do, we'll do.
There's no chance he's going to understand what to do with it. Right. I asked Garza if he wanted to... Well, obviously, Garza had to create a match, so it had to happen. And you know Garza loves the ladies, so Garza created, this is some sort of feverish dream of a match, Eva Marie versus Lana. So that's what we're going to get right here.
Oh, my God.
Wow.
There that goes. Then I asked Garza to make his regular move, and Garza said, sure, he's going to do the old kill and create. And he decided that, he decided to kill Dean Ambrose versus Rusev and get rid of that off of the card.
Damn it, that was going to be sponsored by Men's Warehouse.
And he asked me, is the New Day still available? And I said, yes, the New Day is still available. And then my text was silent for like 10 minutes. And I could hear the wheels turning from all the way down there in Texas, deep in the heart of Texas. The smoke was rising, and I'm like, Garza, what's wrong? Garza, come up with a match. Just create a match. And he's like, screw it. I want Kofi Kingston versus Big E versus Xavier Woods. That's right. Garza booked the New Day Explodes. Three-way match. Kofi versus Big E versus Xavier Woods.
Unless this is in, like, Super Smash Brothers, I disagree.
Fantastic. Well, I mean, feel free to add the stip, Mike. I mean, you got that option.
Oh, no, no. We're going
to do someone needs stuff. To be the studios.
All right, so... Seriously. I'm sorry, both of these things are funny. Okay, move forward for Garza. The stipulation. Garza wants to add a stipulation to the five-way Samoan five-way match. I think you know where this is going.
Wait, can you add a stipulation to a supercard?
Yes, you can.
Okay.
And the stipulation for the five-way is, winner becomes the sole user of the Rock's cousin moniker. If the Rock wins, losers must leave the Anoa'i family. So the Anoa'i family expulsion match. So it's all on the line between the those imposters. All right, and finally, I asked him for a sponsor, and he said, "Add Sunny Side Up to the Sasha versus Becky match hashtag Divas Revolution." So that's where we stand. I'll just scribble that on there real quick. Where's my blue marker? There we go.
God damn it, Garza.
So Garza rained down some hellfire. All right.
I never liked him either.
all right. Now it's time for some live Mayhem Mania action. I hope that didn't take too long. I hope you're all still with me. Only the hardest of the hardcore are still watching. That's okay. First order of business. Sorgy, we got to create a match. You have to create a match to fill this hole now that the others have done their work. So, I can go through it while you're thinking.
I think I'm good.
Right now.
No.
Just
I think I'm good.
Take a minute to think, and I'm going to go through what's on the supercard and what's on the undercard right
okay.
now.
Okay.
Here's what's on the supercard right now, and this is we are up to 5 of 8 matches on the supercard already. We're in good shape. We're looking good. All right? And those 5 matches are Apollo Crews versus Brock Lesnar versus Bray Wyatt, Finn Balor versus Kevin Owens versus Sami Zayn, Shinsuke Nakamura versus AJ Styles, Blake and Murphy versus The Revival versus American Alpha, and in the Anoa'i family expulsion match, Jimmy Uso versus Jey Uso versus The Rock versus Nia Jax versus Roman Reigns. On the undercard, we have 7 matches. Sorg is going to take care of the 8th, but right now we have Eva Marie versus Lana, Sasha Banks versus Becky Lynch, Darren Young versus Michael Tarver, Kofi Kingston versus Big E versus Xavier Woods, Asuka versus Natalya in a ladder match for the Divas title, The Social Outcasts versus Enzo, Big Cass, Ty Dillinger, and Kozlov in a family double dare obstacle course match, and Alberto Del Rio versus Austin Aries. A double. Sorgi.
And I'm filling in a match.
You are creating a match.
Well, I felt bad after last night.
Empty, look at this empty card right here.
Mm-hmm. First of all, I believe you need to write in there Chris Jericho.
In a suit?
as much as I want it to be.
I like how that's a standard question now. Is the guy in a suit?
I'll take him as he is. I'll take him as he is.
Well, yeah, because he's a heel now again, right?
Yeah, yeah, but I'd still rather...
You don't have to specify suit when he's heel.
I do rather him be in a suit, but not necessary for this. I just want him to take on somebody who just needs to tear the house down at WrestleMania. Absolutely, right? Not be the guy that gets beat up for a half an hour to have a comeback, but just... Like back in the day, Jericho had those matches with Kurt Angle and Benoit and Guerrero at WrestleManias. Guerrero? Most of those guys. Or Christian or whatever. And just had match of the year candidates at WrestleMania. And I want that guy to be Dolph Ziggler.
Ziggles. All right.
That's it.
Solid. All right. Now, I told everybody that we would do the live Patreons according to your seniority, but I get the suspicion that necessarily being last is not necessarily where you want to be. So I'm going to let you guys draft your position, basically, out of the three of you, based on your seniority. So longest serving Patreon gets to choose first of where they're going to play. So, honey, do you want to go first, second, or third in line? You want to go first? All right. See? That's what I do. So, Jen's going to go first. And, Mad Mike, you are the second most tenured Patreon here live with us. Would you like to go second or third, Michael?
Oh, I will go last.
Alex Cars, you will bring the reckoning in position number 2. Let's bring the disembodied voice of one half of the Matthew and Jennifer Carlin's Foundation for Podcast Betterment. And let's ask, dear heart. You don't have to come on screen if you want to.
I don't
want to
come on screen. Great. I'm hideous.
The disembodied voice of Jen Carlin's.
Just call
of
me
my God. Wife will now speak. Jen, would you like to graduate one of these 8 lovely matches that are sitting right here on the undercard? You got 8 matches to choose from. You want to graduate one of those? Now, remember, you don't have to. You can deem them all unworthy. So think it over for a second.
I want...
I choose.
I kind of want to see the New Day fall apart.
You want to see the New Day explode?
Yes.
You going to graduate that?
Yes.
Solid.
No. Jen, we were friends.
You made that so mad. He said we were friends, but as we learned, Mayhemania, friendship is temporary.
It's just business.
It's just business. Well, here's the thing. So, Jen, you've left the void here on the undercard.
I sure did.
We need to fill that up.
I sure did.
Do you have perhaps somewhere deep in the recesses of your mind, do you have a match? What the hell was that? Do you have a match for the Mayhemers to create for Mayhem Mania?
I sure do.
Tell me what it is.
We will have Dean Ambrose.
Shocker.
The chair broke in anticipation of what this is going to be. versus
WWE referee Drake,
the WWE referee.
Keeping his last name.
Huh. Younger?
Interesting.
Okay.
I don't think he goes by that.
Yeah, Bobby Dodd, he's chanting CZ Dub.
Yeah.
All right.
All right. Good. I love it.
Is Jen making this a light tube match?
We're going to find out. Okay. Jen, you could still make a traditional move. So you can do like the swap or the add a guy or girl or add a tag team move. Or you can just kill and create if you want to. You can basically make a typical move now in Mayhem Mania. So is there anywhere else you feel maybe this card could be improved? This undercard perhaps could maybe be a bit of an upgrade?
Can I?
You know, Triple H is not on this card, right? He's our champion. I'm just joking. Don't do whatever you want. Good. What were you going to ask? She's shaking her head. You can pass. You don't have to. Yeah, no pressure. You know,
Can I add what type of match for Ambers?
Oh, we'll do that in a second.
Oh, okay.
That's coming up next.
I'm going to pass.
You're going to pass? What kind of stipulation would you like for Dean versus Drake?
I would like a Hell in the Cell.
No. What'd you say?
The barbed wire.
The barbed wire match?
Yes.
Barbed wire with anything else? Just barbed wire? No exploding ring, just barbed wire?
Just barbed wire.
Barbed wire kettle from Hell match?
The ring, the Hell in the Cell is barbed wire.
Barbed wire Hell in a Cell.
That's going to be expensive.
Anybody screws with my match, I will hunt you down and gut you.
Well, this is going to be fun. Stampede.
Jesus.
All right, last question, dear heart.
Yes, honey.
Would you like to add a sponsor, a solid corporate partner to sponsor one of these matches?
Sponsored by Lowe's.
Sponsored by Lowe's?
Yes.
Not Home Depot?
No, Lowe's.
Fair enough. Okay.
That's a lot of barbed wire. That's a lot of fencing.
That's a lot of fencing.
That's a lot. That's
a lot of light tubes.
Yeah.
How do you spell Lowe's? Lowe's. No, that's not right. You're thinking of the movie theaters.
Yeah.
All right, who's up? All right, Alex. Good job, hon. Well, there goes my marker. Okay.
Wow.
Alex, guys. So, would you like to graduate one of these matches?
Well, I just want
to. We've got six part matches already graduated.
I'd like to preface this by saying that when I talked to you about this, I didn't quite realize that we were allowed to potentially do each and every one of these things. So this
I actually asked that very same question.
I wish I had asked this question ahead of time. See,
because I was only prepared by surprise. You could just
That's okay. I intend on doing as much damage to this whole thing.
If you start shifting matches around, like if you graduate a match with a stipulation, that's cool. The stipulation will stick. But if you start moving personnel inside of the match, the stipulation never changes. It's stuck. Stipulations are forever.
So if you wanted to put Michael Tarver in that Family Double Dare match, it'll happen.
No.
That could happen.
So
let's focus one step at a time, Alex.
Yeah, right.
You'd like to graduate a match.
So you said if I graduated a match that had the stipulation, that stipulation stays on the match and that goes to the supercard?
Yes. The stipulation and the match will graduate together.
Okay. So we're actually going to do Jen a favor here because I actually really like that match that she just made.
Yeah.
That she took up most of her turn to make. So I'm going to graduate the barbed wire Hell in a Cell sponsored by Lowe's between Dean Ambrose and the artist formerly known as Drake Younger.
All right.
That match is going to the supercard.
Alex graduated your match.
That means Jen
gets Alex cares forever!
Jen gets an eliminator.
Jen, you get now, an eliminator.
Ah, oh, shit.
Now.
Alex, we need to create a match now.
With great power comes great responsibility. That has nothing to do with what I'm about to do next. That was just a random Marvel reference. So, on the flip side of the coin, where I did at least one person a favor, I'm going to put everyone into misery mode, because the match I'm going to create in that spot is El Torito versus Hornswoggle.
As it should be.
As it should be. Because you guys messed me up this whole time. I tried adding El Torito to the card. Nope. I added Hornswoggle. Nope. So now you're going to get both of them on the card.
The man just wants some little people action. That's all he wants.
So that's the first move I'm making.
You son of a bitch. All right.
That's the second.
Do you want to make your typical move right now? You can swap something. You can trade something. You can kill and create. Want to make a change inside of the undercard here? You want to swap anybody? You want to get rid of one of these matches and bring in a different one?
Oh, it's tempting.
You don't have to.
Do I go by his CCW name or his?
You have to use his WWE name now. I think that's only phase.
Let's see. Okay, so as far as my typical move, I am going to...
Wait, hang on for 1 second, okay. Alex. Bobby, would you like to use one of your eliminators?
Not yet,
okay, good.
Okay.
Sorg, eliminator?
I'm tempted, but no.
Okay, Alex, go ahead.
Oh, actually, that reminds me. Sorg, while I make... quickly decide on whether I'm going to make my typical move or not, I need you to do me a favor and prepare the car's wheel of insanity for the last two parts of my move. I send it to you on Slack.
That's right.
Because that was originally the move that I had in mind, was doing something along those lines. So, taking just a moment. Oh, I'm trying to think. Because the only typical move thing that I want to do is I almost want to add a woman to that ladder match.
This show needs more women.
It really does.
Yeah, I agree.
I couldn't agree more.
We haven't gotten nearly the entire Divas roster on here yet.
Can I add?
Hey,
nope, you're done.
I just realized something. whatever happened to Paige?
Whatever happened to Paige?
She didn't get injured, right?
No, she's fine.
No, Paige is fine. She has gray hair now.
Okay, my typical move is I'm going to add Paige to the ladder match for the Divas title. It is a triple threat.
Good stuff.
Divas title ladder match between Asuka, because I'd like to ask you a question. I guess I already did, and that was what happened to Paige. So that is my typical move match.
Great. Now, all right.
Now we're getting to the fun parts.
Time for a stipulation.
Right. Sorg, do you have the car's wheel of insanity prepared?
Yes, I do. Do you want to read off what your selections are on this board?
Yes. Yes. So I'm going to explain. So the way this is going to work, since I allowed one stipulation and one sponsorship, the first stipulation that pops up will be what goes on to a match, at which point I'll decide what match. So the stipulations I've put on the wheel of insanity are 2 out of 3 falls. WLC.
Yes.
Because of course.
Yes.
Yeah.
The kennel from hell.
Michael Tarver needs that.
Right. The kennel from hell. And I made this generic on purpose, but the lucha de apuestas. That is basically a fight for a wager, and that is usually a hair versus hair, a mask versus mask, etc. So depending on if that pops up or not on the wheel, then we'll figure out the specifics of the wager. And then our sponsorships are Occupy Pro Wrestling, the website that I've been running that now has a podcast of its own, which is pretty fun. Kind of weird to say that I'm a double podcaster. But let's see. The second sponsorship is Chikara in 15 Minutes or Less. The third sponsorship is EW Planet. It is a resource site for electronic e-wrestling or fantasy wrestling, depending on what you know it as. And the last sponsorship on this wheel is a newer project that I've started up called ewmerch.com. Fake wrestling, real merch. Think of it as a pro wrestling tease for e-wrestling.
Alex, you are quite the entrepreneur.
Alex, fun fact, I actually have a shirt for my e-fed wrestler.
That is awesome.
True story. True story.
And I'm going to be talking to you a little bit more after this show now. All right, so that's what's on the wheel. Now, let's go ahead and spin the wheel. And spin the wheel, make the deal.
Spinning. There it goes.
Too bad Kohlmeier's glove match isn't on this.
Rolling.
Man, you really missed the boat.
Slowing. Kennel from hell.
Oh, yes. Yes.
So, we are going to add the kennel of hell.
We're going to have the cage anyways. We might as well do it, right?
Right.
Please add to Eva versus Lana.
Shut up. I don't know. No help from the studio audience.
It's only appropriate. Alex. The kennel from hell is only appropriate for a wrestler that loves to talk about dogs all the time during his matches. Of course, he says this in Spanish, calling everybody pedo. I don't understand. So, in Kennel from Hell, you have Alberto Del Rio versus Austin Aries in Kennel from Hell.
Nice.
Well played.
Did not see that one coming, but
neither did I. Neither did I. I thought you were going to throw the Samoans in Kennel from Hell.
Wow. Double stiff. All right. Alex, do you have a sponsorship, a wildly successful corporate sponsorship you'd like to use?
We're going to spin the wheel. Again, we're going to spin the wheel and make the deal for our sponsorship.
Damn, I closed it.
You closed it.
I didn't realize we're going to do it again. Hold on a second. Hold on. We're reloading the wheel. All right. Give me the word.
Because I have enough faith in all of my projects.
There you go. Give me the word.
Spin it.
Okay. It's spinning. There we go.
VLC
sponsored EWmerch.com.
What?
Sponsored by EWmerch.com.
So your sponsorship, EWmerch.com, presents to you.
Go with the kennel.
I don't know.
No. Go with one from the supercard.
Own it.
It's automatically on there.
Remind me what's on the supercard already. That's the one thing I don't have my notes on.
No problem. We got Apollo Crews versus Brock Lesnar versus Bray Wyatt. We got Nakamura versus Styles. Finn Balor versus Kevin Owens versus Sami Zayn. We got Blake and Murphy versus The Revival versus American Alpha. We've got the Samoan Five-Way, the NOIE Family Expulsion match. We've got the New Day Explodes, Kofi versus Big E versus Xavier. And we've got the Barbed Wire Hell in a Cell match between Dean Ambrose and Drake Wirtz.
All right. Oh, actually, yeah, here we go. EWmerch.com presents a battle between the three guys that presumably everybody's using for their eFed pick base. So Finn Balor.
Yeah. I was gonna say that's Balor.
Which
Owens.
One is that?
That's Balor, Owens, and Zayn.
Versus Sami Zayn. Brought to you by EWmerch.com. And it is a real website, by the way.
Good to know. Excellent. Mike?
All right.
Bobby?
Yes.
Bobby, would you like to use one of your two eliminators?
It's tempting. We're on next week, right?
Oh yeah, we'll be back next week.
I don't think Bobby's gonna predict who I'm using in my match anyway.
No, I won't. I don't want to. I'll wait.
Would you like to graduate a match?
Yes, I would, Matt. I want to graduate the Family Double Dare match.
All right, good deal.
Yes.
Wow, what an instant hit! Good job, Bo Diggity.
Brava. Brava, brava, brava. As soon as you said that, I'm like, that's my pick. All right. in
You're
its
gonna
place,
have to create a match to fill this hole.
In its place, I am creating a 6-person intergender tag.
All right, go ahead.
I am, you know, WrestleMania needs celebrities. God damn it, it needs them.
Does it?
Yes. So we are going to have Snooki,
oh, no.
David Arquette.
Too late to use that eliminator, Matt.
That's what you get.
This is what you get, Bobby.
I mean, Bobby, is there anyone you'd like to eliminate right now?
Oh, he no, said, no, not what I'm announcing, Matt.
Is there anyone else you'd like to eliminate?
Go on, finish.
Not in the middle of the
It's like Money in the Bank. He can come in whenever he wants to.
All
right. Hey, Sorg could just blurt out a name right now and you couldn't use him. But
Snooki, David Arquette, and Kevin Federline versus Ronda Rousey, Stephen Amell, and Karl Malone.
This is going to be an assassination, Mike. What the hell are you doing?
What the hell?
I want Garza to make this graphic. That is my punishment to him.
Sorg and Eamon, do you want to team up to use our eliminators for this match?
Is it per person I can eliminate? Or
yeah.
Nope.
You can't do it once they're on the card.
Already on the card.
The damage is done.
Already on the card.
Can I eliminate a concept?
Nope.
Would anyone like to jump in and scream bloody murder?
I'm making this match fully aware. This match is going to get destroyed next week. I just want Garza to make this match graphic for 1 week. That's it. I need to see this match graphic in person.
Objections?
They've all wrestled on pay-per-views.
One
was a former world champion.
Objections, but I don't think I can do anything about it.
Not if you're an island by yourself. Very well.
Yeah.
I did. You know, you've abused my rule on celebrities. You abused it.
How have I abused it?
I tried to set parameters for celebrity involvement in this game by saying that they had to appear in a WWE ring, and you found 6 people who've appeared in a ring, and you used them all. Mm-hmm.
Hey, you know what? You praised Eamon for abusing the rules. I deserve some praise for this, too. All right.
That was more gamesmanship than abuse.
So is this.
So cagey.
All right. So now I guess.
Like you make like a normal move. You can make a normal move to the undercard. Now's your chance to swap El Torito into this intergender, Mike.
I will just add Bailey to that ladder match.
Okay.
I was going to kill and create, but I figure I've done enough damage.
This thing's getting good.
Mm-hmm.
All right. Do you have a stipulation?
Yes, I do. I'm going to add to the New Day Explodes a Super Smash Brothers Melee on that giant Jerrytron. On that giant Jerrytron. So they're not actually fighting. They're just having a big session of up, up, down, down.
Is that your sponsor?
No. It's not my sponsor.
Who's your sponsor?
My sponsor is the Wrestling Mayhem Show.
I should have done these masking tape loops in advance.
Probably.
I'm going to get that right next time.
My sponsor is the Wrestling Mayhem Show, Matt.
Well, dadgum, Mike, which match are you going to sponsor with the Wrestling Mayhem Show? We got like 8 on the supercard to choose from here.
Nakamura versus AJ Styles, naturally. WMS
presents. Boom, Shaka! AJ Styles. See, I told you it would be okay and we would make a great WrestleMania card. Look what we did together. All right. Well, we've got 8 matches on the supercard. You want me to run these down, Sorg? Do we still have any light? There's a light still on? Sorg, are you awake?
Sure, go for it.
Want to use your eliminator now, Sorg?
No.
Now's the time to eliminate Jay Leno before it's too late.
What?
Eliminate Jay Leno before it's too late.
Oh.
The supercard is Apollo Crews versus Brock Lesnar versus Bray Wyatt, Nakamura versus Styles, sponsored by Wrestling Mayhem Show, Finn Balor versus Kevin Owens versus Sami Zayn, sponsored by EWMerch.com, Blake and Murphy versus The Revival versus American Alpha. We've got the Samoan 5-Way, the NOIE Family Expulsion match. We've got Kofi versus Big E versus Xavier Woods, Super Smash Brothers Melee on the big screen at Jerry World. We've got the Social Outcasts versus Enzo and Big Cass and Ty Dillinger and Kozlov in a family double dare obstacle course match presented by Space Camp. We've got Dean Ambrose.
For that graphic, they all need to have the double dare shirts on.
We're going to get that. Teams. All yeah. in the shirts. Garza, you hear that?
Yeah, Garza.
Garza hates Garza,
and helmets. It's family double dare. They have
it's
to
family
have
double dare. Shirts. It has to happen, man. You have to do it. With the slime behind them, too. Do it. Don't.
And Mark
don't
Summers in a Mark Summers in a referee.
Yeah, Mark Summers. Why didn't someone get Mark Summers special referee one of these matches? You screwed it up.
I thought of
you
it afterwards.
You blew it,
afterwards.
Man.
He'll probably be on. He'll probably guest commentator.
Yeah, that'd be a good idea. Dean Ambrose versus Drake Wirtz in a barbed wire Hell in a Cell match, sponsored by Lowe's. Now we've got 8 matches left. I told you we were going to do 8 matches, try to fill 8 slots on the supercard. Well, we've got 8 matches on the supercard. We've got 8 matches left. What's there left to fight for? I've come up with something worth fighting for. A spot on the pre-show, of course. So next week, we'll continue our little game. We'll have one more round. We'll play our little game with these 8 remaining matches. And then we'll do a poll on the Wrestling Mayhem Show Facebook group. And we'll decide which match gets to be on the pre-show. Will it be Eva Marie versus Lana? Sasha Banks versus Becky Lynch? Sponsored by Sunnyside Up. Darren Young versus Michael Tarver. El Torito versus Hornswoggle. Asuka versus Bayley versus Natalya versus Paige in a 4-way ladder match for the Divas title. Snooki, David Arquette, and Kevin and Federline versus Ronda Rousey, Stephen Amell, and Karl Malone. Chris Jericho, not in a suit, versus Dolph Ziggler.
Not in a suit.
And Alberto Del Rio versus Austin Aries. In a Kennel from Hell match.
Hey, Carlins, I'd like to point out a couple of things. One, did we actually get a full supercard last year before the last week? Okay.
Yes. We ended up like 2 or 3 matches short, and we used the Facebook poll to decide the last 3 matches. But we did even better this year because we had more Patreons because in case nobody didn't realize is that the whole purpose of this is to make bank for Sorgatron. And we did it. So, Sorg, how long did this take? Was that 45 minutes?
It was a while.
Would you like to use your eliminator?
I'm Matt Hardy's child.
Matt Hardy's child?
Oh.
All right, I'll take that, Bonnie. You spoke it. All right, we'll do
I'm
it.
Kidding, I'm kidding, by the way.
Bobby, you still have one more eliminator. Would you like to also eliminate Jeff Hardy's child?
That's not my eliminator.
That's not your eliminator? All right. Well, join us next week when Bobby will be armed with 2 eliminators. Sorg will have an eliminator. And Stosh from Max Out will have an eliminator. And I have a feeling no one's going to get eliminated.
Bo Diggity has an eliminator as well. Yes.
The other.
That's right. Yeah. These things all graduate. Okay. I got to keep track of all these things that we graduated.
So the other thing that I'd like to point out, slightly more selfish, is that this is the first time since I've been on this year that something I created didn't get destroyed.
Yeah.
I appreciate that.
Yet.
No one's match got destroyed, right? Well, you know what? This one got jacked up a couple
times. It got added to.
That's still altered. I'll have to check the tape. I'm going to have to check the tape. We may have to come up with a new dose of punishment. We might need some punishment. That'll be a shame. Well, that'll be fun, though.
I added to that
Garza.
So technically that would be me.
Yeah, everyone's got an eliminator now. No one's safe. Where's Randy? All right. Sorgatron.
Where's Randy? Where's Triple H?
Wrong show, Matt.
Sorg, I told you everything would be fine. Was I lying?
You're not wrong.
True. That is true. All right. It's a mayhem mania. It's mayhem. It's time to learn. What did you... find out what you guys learned from wrestling this week. Holy crap. Mad Mike.
I learned that wrestling is fun, you guys. And so is making a whole bunch of moves for a fantasy book WrestleMania.
Wow.
I agree.
It's involved. Matt Carlins, what did you learn about life this week?
Jeez, I learned so much. I learned that While everyone is sitting at home hating the episode of Raw that they're watching, you're at the arena loving every minute of it.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. What about you, Alex Cars?
I learned a lot of stuff. So I learned that dreams can come true. That you can have, at least preliminarily speaking, El Torito versus Hornswoggle. I really don't have much because per my usual amount of being up here on the mountain, I really have not seen a lot of wrestling. I learned that I need more wrestling in my life. That might be it.
There you go. There you go. Bobby, you're out there somewhere, right?
Yeah, I learned that Ryback is rusty by hot dogs.
Yes. All
right. Right when Ryback came out, the Burger King hot dog thing come up, and I busted out laughing.
I learned that whenever Colt Cabana has blocked you on Twitter, just send a girl to ask him to unblock you. Works. That's what I learned. I won't tell you which account it was. But anyways,
need more on that story.
Maybe there'll be a
hey. On a similar, does anybody know how to get unblocked by Brian Alvarez? Because that happened to me. I need some help with that.
Well, we know who to send.
You should probably give him money. I bet that would help.
Send an apology email into the show. That'll probably do it.
All right. A half-hearted apology email is forthcoming.
All right, guys. It was a blast. It's Mayhem Mania. If you're still with us, let us know on @MayhemShow on the Twitters. Drop us a line 412-206-WMS0. WrestlingMayhemShow.com. Subscribe. And if you like this kind of shenanigans, please go let us know in a comment over on iTunes, live.WrestlingMayhemShow.com, the405media.com, where we're streaming every week. And usually they like to put us on in the midnight hour. So if you're staying up too late and want to catch some random mayhem, that would be the place to do that. Yeah, the405media.com. And of course, we're here every Tuesday night live at WrestlingMayhemShow.com about 9 p.m. Eastern time. And as long as we feel like it seems. So thank you so much, everybody, at Mad Mike 4883 on the Twitters, at Mainstream Matt. And check out his columns on WrestlingMayhemShow.com and IndieWrestling.us. Also go to CBSPittsburgh.com for some stuff with Cesaro and Alexa Bliss over the last week as well.
Two-time Cesaro interviewer. He has not swung me yet.
Yeah, that's right. And, of course, Alex Carrs of Power to the Smarks on the tweeters and the great podcast. And, of course, Chikara in 15 minutes or less. Anything else?
Nope, that's it. I got all my plugs out during the...
He did. Mayhem he did. Mania. Yeah, he really did. He really did. And of course, Bobby FJ Town of InsertCoin2Begin.com. New boss battles I see trickling through. So yep. Go check those out.
All right,
well.
Another one coming up.
There you go. We'll see you guys next time. Mayhem out. Just wait. Just wait. Just wait. Just wait. This show is a member of the Sorgatron Media Podcast Network. Find out more at sorgatronmedia.com. You guys are cool.
Hey, Daniel Perry again. Hey, I know you guys got a live stream coming up a little bit later on tonight, but I just want to tell you what I've learned from wrestling this week. Sami Zayn will be the next Daniel Bryan, and Ryback will be the next CM Punk. You ever watch the footage from between Ryback and Curtis Axel, you'll see what I mean. All right, guys. Well, hope you guys have a good day, and I'll look at your recap on Wednesday. Take care. Bye.